I don't think on a permanent basis we should expect much change in the employment outcomes, but certainly price stability outcomes, I think, would be better on, have been better under gold standards. I'll provide you with some evidence of that. Anyway, the economists who answered this question were drawn from Harvard, Yale, Stanford, Berkeley, Chicago, and Princeton. So at the elite educational institutions, gold standard is not taken seriously. If you look at the participants' responses more closely, here are some of the people were invited to give comments. So here are some of the critiques of the gold standard. Some claiming that gold is not a stable standard. I don't know what time series he's looking at, unless he's looking at the price series of gold since it was demonetized. I think that's what he must be looking at. Since 1971, when the last link between the US dollar and gold was severed, then the price of gold has been quite volatile. But that's because it's been demonetized. Other economists, Robert Hall, who I respect, says the instability of the relative price of gold is way too high. Again, that's been a problem since the demonetization of gold. Here's my most intolerant response. Love of the gold standard implies macroeconomic illiteracy. That's almost breathtakingly arrogant, I would think. This is the Nancy Stokes is kind of the standard reasonable Chicago school response. There are better ways to avoid excessive inflation while maintaining the flexibility of a fiat currency. Now, I'm not sure why she said flexibility, but the standard argument, going back to Milton Friedman, has long been, we can reproduce the virtues of the gold standard, we can reproduce the price stability, but without digging up gold, without the resource costs of having a gold standard. That's been an argument over the years. I'll have something to say about that later. Here are the three economists who had something, two of the three, had something favorable to say about the gold standard, although they still disagreed with the proposition. Acemoglu says the gold standard would have avoided the policy mistakes of the 2000s. Well, that seems to be like a pretty strong argument in favor of the gold standard. It's one I've made myself in an article in the Cato Journal, I think the title of which was, A Gold Standard with Free Banking Would Have Avoided the Boom and the Bust. Ed Lazier says the gold standard adds credibility when a country lacks discipline. I think that's another important argument. And we see many countries adopting policies like the gold standard, dollarization, euroization, when otherwise the currency lacks credibility. It says the cost in monetary policy flexibility. Well, that's right. It does tie the hands of the authorities. That's the virtue, actually. But he says the trade-off is unclear in the U.S. Well, if it's unclear in the U.S., then in countries where central banks have been less responsible, seems like the trade-off would go in favor of the gold standard. But Richard Thaler, why tie to gold? Why not the price of wine? Well, there are reasons, actually. But let's be clear about what a gold standard means, because it's often poorly defined in the literature. People will sometimes say a gold standard was a policy under which a central bank had a commitment to buy and sell gold at a fixed price or something like that. That's not a very good or very generic definition, because it isn't necessary to have a central bank in order to have a gold standard or to have a treasury policy. Historically, gold standards arose long before, and before gold standards, silver standards, arose long before central banks. So it's odd to define them in terms of what a central bank does. The way I define it is to say that gold is a medium of account, that is, prices are denominated in units of gold, and gold's the medium of redemption. Ordinary transactions typically take place in bank-issued money. People write checks or make, these days, deposit transfers. They carry around paper currency in a gold standard that's a claim for gold typically issued by a commercial bank. Gold is the stuff in the bank's vault that redeems the deposits and redeems the banknotes. So there's nothing essential in the definition of a gold standard that requires a central bank to exist. There are, of course, varieties of gold standards depending on what the redemption medium is. Historically, where it wasn't interfered with, in the market, people wanted redemption for gold coins. But there were economists like David Ricardo who said, well, we can have a cheaper gold standard by only redeeming for large blocks of bullion, right, gold bars. Then we can use cheaper substitutes for everyday currency. So that's a gold bullion standard instead of a gold coin standard. There are different kinds of systems for issuing the gold redeemable currency. Historically, commercial banks took this, or naturally, in the absence of government interference, commercial banks took on this function, but governments often monopolized it. So that makes it a different kind of standard, because the promise of a central bank where it's the only game in town, where it has no competitors in issuing redeemable banknotes, and where it has sovereign immunity against lawsuits should it fail to follow through on its contract, that makes the standard very much more tenuous than when private institutions are bound by their contracts to redeem their liabilities for gold. In a decentralized system like that, any one bank could fail, and yet it doesn't end the gold standard, because there are 20 other banks that will redeem their obligations for gold. Right? It just means the failure of that one bank. But if there's only a single monopolistic central bank and it decides to suspend the gold standard, that's the end of it. Right? If it won't redeem, there's nowhere to get gold anymore. And the money floats against gold. So that is a different kind of gold standard. And there are different rules for gold reserve holding. Historically, it was typically a matter of free contract between the bank and its customers. And typically, a deposit contract didn't oblige the bank to hold any particular reserve ratio. But there are economists who advocate that we should restrict that freedom of contract to compelling the bank against its demand deposits. Anything that's redeemable on demand should have 100% reserve, in their view. So actually, it's no longer a bank. In that respect, it now becomes just a warehouse. My view is that that's an unjustified limitation on freedom of contract. So I like to mention that because the subtitle of this conference has free banking in it, so I wanted to mention that. How does a gold standard work? One way to approach the question is to ask what determines the purchasing power of the monetary unit, or what determines the price level, as we normally approach it these days. So if you think of the price level as, I think of this symbol as dollar, but actually it's only got one stripe through it, so it could just as well be peso. If you think of the unit of account as a dollar, then the question is, how many dollars does it take to buy a standard basket of goods? Under a gold standard, you can break that into two components. What's the relationship between dollars and ounces of gold? How many dollars are equivalent to an ounce of gold? I wouldn't say buy, because it's not something that takes place at a floating price. If the unit of account is defined in terms of gold, then it's a definitional relationship between the dollar and so many ounces of gold. Right? So it's the par redemption rate. And then you can ask the question, what's the purchasing power of gold in terms of goods and services? How many ounces of gold does it take to buy a standard basket of goods? And that does vary depending on supply and demand for gold, depending relative to supply and demand for other goods and services. So if we talk about S, this variable S, as the purchasing power of gold, that is determined by supply and demand for gold, and we can, in exchange for other goods and services, so we can analyze what will affect the value of gold, what will affect the purchasing power of the dollar in terms of supply and demand forces in the market for gold. To do that, to talk about supply and demand for monetary gold, we need to make a very basic distinction between stocks and flows. Right? So when we talk about money demand, we have in mind a stock. If we call the unit of account a dollar, it would be how many dollars do individuals want to have on hand at a point in time, or on average over the month, how many dollars do they want to hold? But when we talk about the supply of gold, we totally normally think about it in flow dimensions. Right? There's both a stock dimension, how many ounces of monetary gold exist today, and there's a flow dimension, how many ounces of gold are being produced and coined each year. So we have to reconcile those two to have a complete picture of the forces at work. So here's the flow, supply, and demand diagram, right, where we've got, as usual, what do I have first? The supply curve is upward sloping, which tells you that at a higher, on the vertical axis, I have the purchasing power of gold. An upward sloping supply curve, which, right, as usual, means that at a higher value per ounce of gold, it pays to produce more per year. Miners will dig a little deeper if the gold is more valuable. And in the long run, they will open more mines. They'll go prospecting more to produce more ounces of gold per year. The downward sloping supply curve for the flow of gold is not monetary demand, because that's a stock demand. This is the industrial demand for gold. Right? It's a commodity money. George Selgin provided this distinction yesterday between fiat money and commodity money. Because it's a commodity money, it has other uses, and this demand curve represents the demand for gold in those other uses. So for making high-end audio cables, for filling teeth, for making jewelry is probably the most important. Call that the industrial demand for gold, if you like. But we also have to talk about monetary stocks, the supply and demand for monetary stocks of gold. So at any point in time, if this is the stock of gold being used for monetary purposes, there's an upward sloping supply curve, and it gets steeper and steeper because there's gold laying around in other forms. There's jewelry that can be melted down to be used as money, melted down and coined. And so that's what's shown in the upward sloping supply curve. As the purchasing power of gold goes up, it becomes more and more expensive, more and more costly to hang on to gold jewelry and gold candlesticks, and people will be willing to melt them down because they can get more of other things. Right? But there's a limit because there's only so much gold existing at a point in time. So it gets steeper and steeper as it approaches the limit. Right, so this is the supply curve of monetary gold by conversion from existing gold in other forms. And to that, in the long run, we have to bring in the supply, the flow supply. Right? But right here, this is just the stock supply. And then we have a downward sloping stock demand curve for the reason that at a lower purchasing power of gold, you need more units to make the same purchases. So if you think of people having a demand to have real money balances, a certain amount of wealth in a form that enables them to purchase whatever they want to purchase quickly, you have a downward sloping demand curve. And it has this shape such that the real purchasing power of what people hold will be the same. Right? People want real purchasing power, then that implies that the demand curve has this shape. So at every point along the demand curve, the product of the purchasing power of gold and the number of ounces is the same. If the purchasing power of gold is twice as high, you need half as many ounces. Okay, so now we have to bring the two things together, and sort of the linchpin of this system is going to be that the purchasing power of gold has to be the same in the two markets, both in the industrial supply and demand market and in the monetary supply and demand market. Because of arbitrage, because people can melt down gold and coin it if they want to do that, or they can go the opposite way. If the value of gold is higher in industrial uses, they can melt down coins and use them to make circuits or fill teeth or whatever. Sort of the benchmark or the starting point for doing analysis is a stationary equilibrium where none of the curves is shifting, right? That's kind of our standard approach. That has some funny implications in the case of a monetary standard. It implies that in this equilibrium, the mints are completely idle. They're not coining anything. The money supply is not growing. But that actually describes a lot of mints during the gold standard era. They just sat around until a bunch of metal came in to be coined, or until it was called in to be coined by a monarch who wanted to debase the currency. There were exceptions, of course. The Spanish mint had a steady flow coming from the New World for many centuries, but the English mint was idle many years. Okay, so if we start from this kind of equilibrium in which everybody's satisfied with their gold holdings and the industrial supply and demand are clearing, then we can subject it to supply and demand shocks and see how the system responds, in particular see how the purchasing power of gold responds. So we've got four different curves, and each one can move in two different directions, so that's potentially eight different thought experiments we can conduct, but we don't have that much time. So let me just give you an example. Suppose there's an increase in the stock monetary demand for gold. A slow process that would do that would be growing income leads people to want to hold bigger money balances. But if you want a dramatic shift, suppose some large country joins the gold standard after having been on a fiat standard or on a silver standard. And so the system people want gold coins now. And they're going to have to import a lot of gold to turn the bank reserves into gold and to turn the currency, the coins, into gold. From what they previously were. So that's a upward shift in the demand, the worldwide stock monetary demand for gold, and that's going to raise the purchasing power of gold, right? If Germany joins the gold standard and starts buying lots of gold, that's going to drive up the purchasing power of gold in the world market. But that can't be the end of the story, right? So we reach in the short run this equilibrium where we've taken some of the world stock of gold and converted it into monetary form. Right, from the world as a whole point of view, if you take coins from one country to another, it doesn't change the monetary stock. But if you melt down some candlesticks, that increases the monetary stock. But that can't be the end of the story, because that new purchasing power of gold no longer represents a stationary equilibrium in the flow market. At a higher purchasing power of gold, gold miners want to produce more, and industrial users want to consume less. So we've got a discrepancy here. More gold is now being produced than is being taken up by the industrial users. Where can it go? If you're producing more gold than you can sell to industrial users, you can always take it to the mint. And by taking it to the mint, the stock of monetary gold is going to grow. So the response to this excess supply in the flow market is going to be a gradual growth in the monetary stock. So over time, the monetary stock supply curve is going to shift to the right. And how long is it going to keep shifting? Well, it's going to keep shifting as long as there's a positive flow over here going into the mints. And that's going to happen as long as the purchasing power of gold is above the old stationary equilibrium point. So the old stationary equilibrium purchasing power of gold gets reestablished, right? Purchasing power of gold at the end of the process is going to be the same as it was at the beginning, barring certain complications that I'll mention in a minute. So in the long run, the supply of gold, the stock supply of monetary gold, responds to the increased demand, satisfies the increased demand, so the supply of money responds to the demand for money, and in the long run there's no change in the purchasing power of money. It's totally a quantity response and not a price level response. Right? So the purchasing power of gold stabilizes itself. It has this tendency, because it's a commodity being produced by profit-seeking producers, you get more of it if the purchasing power goes up, and that brings the purchasing power back down to the point at which there's no longer an incentive to produce more. And this, of course, is the great virtue of the gold standard that's long been emphasized by its proponents, that it's self-stabilizing. And this is just an illustration of how that works. But there's another kind of shock that does not reverse itself in its effects on the purchasing power of gold. What I said about self-reversing changes in the purchasing power is going to be true of any change in the stock market that doesn't affect the flow market, because in the long run, the flow equilibrium is going to determine the purchasing power of gold. But if we have a change in the flow market, that'll have a permanent effect. So suppose there's a new gold mining area opened up, California, 1849, right? Suddenly, even before the first gold coins start coming out of California, there's an increase in the number of ounces of gold that can be mined every year. So there won't be an immediate impact on the purchasing power of gold, but there will be an impact over time, because now we once again have an excess supply in the flow market. The quantity being produced exceeds the quantity demanded for industrial uses at that purchasing power. And so once again, the stock supply curve is going to shift out over time. How far is it going to shift? It's going to shift until we reach the new intersection of the flow supply and demand curves. All right, so the importance of this is that this is a permanent change in the purchasing power of gold. And this is what's been emphasized, of course, by the critics of the gold standard. It's subject to non-monetary supply and demand and monetary supply and demand shocks. Right? Because the control of the money supply is not centralized in the central bank, there are sort of arbitrary random things that can happen, like the supply of gold in California being discovered, or the gold fields in California opening up, that will permanently change the purchasing power of gold. So then the question of whether the gold standard is a better performer than a fiat money standard becomes an empirical question. How unstable was the supply really, empirically, historically, compared to how unstable the supply of fiat money has been? Right? Well, so here's what I take from the historical record, and I'll give you some evidence of this, some graphic evidence of this next. But inflation rates have been lower, noticeably lower, under gold and silver standards by contrast to fiat standards. And why do we care about that? Well, inflation is bad for a lot of reasons. The sort of simplest reason is that it levies a tax on people holding money. It makes it more costly to hold on to money if its value is eroding in your pocket. The value is washing away in your pocket, then you don't want to hold so much of it. And that means that people have to resort to other ways of doing their transactions that involve keeping their money balances low. In the case where people save by holding money, it's a tax on saving. Now that's an empirical question, how important that is, but evidence suggests that in countries with more inflation, you get less saving. That although there are ways to get an inflation premium on some kinds of savings that offsets inflation, it doesn't completely offset it, and so people save less, and there's less, therefore less capital formation, and therefore lower growth in countries with higher inflation. Now, many critics of the gold standard will concede, right? They just have to look at the average inflation rate numbers and say, okay, the inflation rate was lower under the classical gold standard, but, and this is the monetarist response I mentioned earlier, we could reproduce that if we had better monetary policy in a fiat money standard. Well, could in some sense on a blackboard, right? And so that kind of criticism, it is just kind of unfair. On a blackboard, in the absence of disturbing situations, I could demonstrate that a gold standard gives you the optimal rate of inflation because the price level would be falling at the real rate of interest due to, anybody studied extraction economics, what's called the hoteling rule is that if you have a choice between digging up gold that's in the ground and not digging it up, you want to leave it in the ground as long as it's rising in purchasing power at the same rate that you could earn by investing somewhere else in the economy. So gold in the ground should be appreciating at the real rate of interest. But if the purchasing power of gold is growing at the real rate of interest, that gives you what's known as the optimum quantity of money, gives you a zero nominal interest rate, gives you a negative inflation rate at the real rate of interest. Voila. Okay, but if we want to compare actual with actual, which I think is the more relevant comparison, actual fiat standards have not delivered on this hypothetical promise to deliver as good or better purchasing power stability. All right, so that's number one. Two, and this is a surprise to most critics of the gold standard, it actually provides lower price level uncertainty. And the reason that's a surprise to them is they look at the wrong measure of inflation uncertainty or price level uncertainty. Sorry, the right measure is price level uncertainty. They tend to look at the variance of the inflation rate. And the inflation rate does bounce around under the gold, did historically bounce around under the gold standard within a fairly small range. But then the year-to-year variation in the gold, in the inflation rate under current fiat standards is generally pretty small. Right? There's a lot of inertia in it. If its inflation rate is 2% this year, it's probably going to be between 1% and 3% the next year. That's true under current fiat standards. The difference is there's no anchor under current fiat standards. It could be 3% this year. There's no tendency, if it's 3% this year, for it to come down next year. It's just as likely to go up to 4% than as to come back down to 2%. And so if you think about where is the price level going to be compared to today, there's much more uncertainty because inflation rates are not anchored. There's no tendency for the price level to mean revert under current fiat standards. But there was under the gold standard for the reasons I just showed you, that if the purchasing power of gold gets low, gold miners will stop mining so much. And if it gets high, they'll mine more. So there's price level stabilization under the gold standard, but not under fiat standards. So if you ask yourself, do I want to buy a 20-year bond? Under a gold standard, you can be pretty sure, right? You have a bond denominated in dollars, and you trust that the relationship between dollars and gold is not going to change. Or you write the contract such that if it changes, you get as many ounces of gold as will buy a dollar in the future, a gold clause in the contract, then you can be pretty sure that you're going to get in real purchasing power terms what you're bargaining for. Because the purchasing power of gold is not going to be very different 20 years from now than what it is today. The statistics show that. But if you ask yourself under a fiat standard, do I want to buy a 20-year bond? You say, well, there's a lot of uncertainty about, I'm making a contract to be paid back in dollars 20 years from now. What's a dollar going to buy 20 years from now? Okay, I know that the average inflation rate is 2%, but there's nothing anchoring the inflation rate to 2%. Over the next 20 years, it could be 10%. It could be 0%, who knows? And the physical evidence of this, well, the market evidence of this is, if you look at the bond, long-term bond markets, they're much thinner today than they were under the classical gold standard. And that's definitely a cost to the economy. It's hard to quantify, but it means that businesses are less willing, because it's more dangerous, to make long-term investments that are financed by long-term bond issues. The market doesn't want long-term bonds. Right? You have to pay a big premium to lock in your money for long terms because of the price level uncertainty. Third, one of the great benefits of the gold standard was that it was non-political, and therefore it could be international. It wasn't the obligation, the currency wasn't the obligation of any national government. Then you can have reliably fixed exchange rates across countries. So we all know the traditional accounting of the benefits of fixed exchange rates. When they're really credibly fixed, as they were under an international gold standard, because gold is the same from country to country, no government can change the chemical composition of a gold coin. Well, I should take that back. Governments can debase their gold coins, but they don't change the purchasing power of gold by doing that. So in the absence of debasement, and debasement was, of course, a very popular government policy during the Middle Ages, but it was pretty much died out in the 19th century. You have lower transaction costs, you have lower devaluation risk in making cross-border investments. There's this beautiful passage in one of Keynes's writings from around the turn of the century talking about how under the classical gold standard, you could put some gold coins in your pocket in London, take a boat over to the continent, and just spend them, right, without worrying about their being accepted or having to stop and change money for at an exchange rate that you couldn't predict. So you get more globalization. The first era of globalization is under the classical gold standard, and I'll provide some evidence of that. Now, I said the traditional monetarist critique of the gold standard was we can reproduce its purchasing power stability without incurring the gold mining costs. But in practice, that hasn't happened since we left the last vestiges of the gold standard. So the process of leaving the gold standard has been quite long. The classical gold standard died in the First World War. The economist Leland Yeager was once asked, "Do you favor returning to the gold standard?" And he says, "Yes, provided that we can repeal the First World War." But the First World War put an end to the classical gold standard. There were kind of pseudo attempts to restore something like a gold standard between the wars, but really monetary chaos. And after the Second World War, of course, the Bretton Woods system, in which gold still played a role because the US dollar was pledged. Probably an important argument for the gold standard that is now becoming even more salient is that the gold standard provided a kind of fiscal discipline that fiat money standards don't provide. Right? It's too easy to turn the crank and issue more money if it's not backed by anything. And governments in fiscal desperation, right, who can't pay their bills otherwise, will give in to the temptation. Now, okay, so fiscal discipline. I'll say a little more about that. So here are some pictures now. So that's what the pictures are going to show you, but here are the pictures themselves. So here's a picture showing the lower mean inflation rate. This is the U.S. price level, and I've shaded in yellow the area under the gold standard. So in the Civil War, the U.S. left the gold standard, restored it in 1879. Between 1879 and the First World War is the period of the classical gold standard. And you can see there's some downward drift in the price level, but then it begins to come back up again. And it begins to come back up because of the self-correcting property of a gold standard. As the purchasing power of gold got higher, which it does when the price level goes down, more prospectors go out looking for gold. It wasn't an accident, really, that they found gold in the Yukon in the 1890s. There was a big reward for finding it because the purchasing power of gold was high. So that's actually part of the long-run supply response. And it wasn't an accident that the cyanide process for extracting gold from low-grade ore was discovered. People had been working on that for years because the purchasing power of gold was high. So at the end of the period, the price level is basically where it was at the beginning. The inflation rate is very close to zero over that period as a whole. But here's the interwar period where you see things are, there's quite a lot of variation in the purchasing power of the dollar. But here's the post-1971, and you can see it's off to the races. Maybe I should stretch the scale out more so you could see how rapid the inflation rate is. But Not only is it rapid, but there doesn't seem to be any fixed inflation rate, and that's part of the price level uncertainty that I mentioned earlier. Here's the United Kingdom, and that gives us some more information because the U.S. doesn't rejoin the gold standard until 1879. Here we've got a much longer period. Britain, after the Napoleonic Wars, rejoins the gold standard in 1819 and then leaves it in the First World War. And you can see how flat that trend is, right? Purchasing power of, sorry, the price level of the pound, because it's linked to gold at a fixed rate, is very stable during this period. They make a, this jump in the price level is the First World War, and then Britain tries to rejoin the gold standard, but look at how much higher the price level was when they tried to rejoin in 1931 compared to where it was when they left the gold standard. That's a problem if you try to go back at the old gold content of the pound sterling. Because now a pound buys a lot less, but there's no reason to think gold buys a lot less. So if you relink to gold, people are going to say, great, I will cash in my pound sterling for gold and go buy lots of stuff on the world market. I can get more stuff on the world market because prices are higher in pound sterling than they are in gold. Well, that, of course, made it impossible to maintain the gold standard. Gold flowed out of England, and they left the gold standard very soon thereafter. But don't blame that, the fact that they couldn't stay on it at the wrong parity, on the gold standard. Right? So the collapse of exchange rate pegs during the interwar period, this is a popular critique of what's called the gold standard. Barry Eichengreen calls it the golden fetters problem, that the monetary authorities were fettered by the gold standard. Well, that's normally a good thing, but if you try to relink at the wrong parity, it's going to be a problem. But that's a problem not created by the gold standard. It's a problem created by leaving the gold standard, inflating, and then trying to go back without either changing the parity or disinflating. You have to do one of those two things if it's going to last. Here's a chart that shows a lot of countries with their average inflation rates under gold and silver standards. Those are shown in the dark bars, commodity standards, versus their inflation rates under fiat standards. Right, so this is something that has applied across countries. This is not just a fluke of a few countries that fiat money has higher inflation rates than commodity standards. Every country in the sample. This is from a paper by Rolnick and Weber, who looked for as many episodes of countries being on and off commodity standards as they could so that they could compare the two. This is the German hyperinflation, the one that has a break in it because the numbers are too high to fit. But even if you throw out the German hyperinflation, here are the average differences. And there were three different versions of their paper, two working papers and then a published version, where they had different samples, so they got slightly different numbers. But this kind of gives you the range of reasonable estimates. Commodity money inflation rates over these episodes, either minus a half or as much as 1.75. I think that one's too high. But fiat money inflation rates, 6.5% at the low estimate, 13% at the high estimate. So big differences, right? Like 7 percentage points to 12 percentage point differences. Here's a table from a paper by Bordeaux and Schwartz showing inflation in five countries under gold standards and under post-war standards. And again, inflation rates under gold standards are very close to zero. They throw in Japan, which brings their mean above zero. But the post-war inflation rates are higher. They have a mean of 5.3. But that paper was, well, okay, up to 1995. All right, so that's the kind of undeniable evidence about average inflation rates. Here's what is often overlooked, the price level uncertainty. And these are charts are from a paper that George and I co-authored with a time series econometrician named Bill LaStraps. So he gets most of the credit for these diagrams. But this one tries to measure price level uncertainty by asking how much did the price level vary over a six-year period? What's the standard deviation? And then for each year, that's compared to the 3 years on either side. So it's a rolling standard deviation. So here's the classical gold standard, and you can see the deviation of the price level around its sample is very small. Within its sample is very small. Here's the interwar period, crazy variations. Here's the post-war period before 1971. And in the 1950s and 60s even, performance had gotten back to being pretty good. But after 1971, it took off again. And recently, it's come back down a bit. So we've gotten back to better performance. We still don't see it in the long-term bond market, so they don't trust it so much. But the average performance after leaving commodity standards has been much worse. And here's another way to look at it. If you look at the variance of your forecast of the price level 30 years out based on what you could observe previously, during the period before the Federal Reserve, this is the Civil War period. Am I reading that right? It's hard to see the numbers. Maybe that's the First World War. It's pretty flat. Not much risk involved in buying a 30-year bond. But after World War II, there's been much, much higher level of risk. And you can see that recently it actually hasn't come down. So just look at the level of the two, which are on the same scale. So that's kind of a hidden cost of having a fiat money standard. The fact that nothing is anchoring the price level makes it very dangerous to make long-term fixed dollar commitments. And so that discourages long-term contracts, long-term debt contracts, that discourages long-term investment. And as I said, it's hard to quantify how much investment that discourages or how much that's reduced the economy's growth rate, but it's a thing to worry about. Here's some statements about the network benefits of having an international gold standard. Coordination on a similar commodity regime is correlated with higher trade. So two countries that are on the same monetary standard, reliably on the same monetary standard under the classical gold standard, will have more trade. So trade flows, they estimate, were about 30% higher. Right? So that enhances prosperity. And the fact that more countries were joining the gold standard helps to explain perhaps 20% of why there was increasing globalization. So it's not the whole story by any means. Falling transportation costs are, of course, important. But it helped the first era of globalization. Danny Roderick, who's actually no friend of the gold standard, nonetheless conceded that by many measures, the world economy was more integrated at the height of the gold standard than it is now. Here's some evidence on the resource costs I mentioned on the real price of gold. So here it is in the classical gold standard period. It's actually lower during the interwar period, but that was a problem of the interwar period. They tried to keep the real price of gold artificially low. Countries tried to run gold standards without much gold, and they weren't able to do it. And so it broke down. In 1971, we left the gold standard, and the real price of gold since then is much higher. So that's led to more gold mining. And finally, fiscal discipline, and I just leave you with this quote from Thomas Sargent, who had this to say, and this is from an interview he gave before he got the Nobel Prize. He hasn't been quite so forthright. This seems to be backwards, right? After you get the prize, you can say whatever you like, and people will take it seriously. But whereas if you don't want to disqualify yourself from the prize by saying something that's considered beyond the pale, you might not say it. But he said this in 2010, so give him credit for that. Remember, under the gold standard, there was no law that restricted your debt-to-GDP ratio. Feasibility and credit markets did the job. If a country wanted to be on the gold standard, it had to balance its budget in a present value sense. What does that mean? If you're on the gold standard, you can't issue bonds except bonds that are repayable in gold, and you can't print gold. So a government that promises to repay people in gold has to be credibly committed to running the budget surpluses necessary to retire the debt later on. Right? That's what he means by balancing your budget in a present value sense. You don't have to balance it every year, but if you run a deficit this year, you have to be committed to running a surplus big enough in future years to repay the debt that you're incurring this year. Otherwise, the world market will not buy your bonds. They won't trust you. Why didn't that work in the European Central Bank system, in the Eurozone? Why didn't that keep Greece from taking on too much debt, the fact that they couldn't print their own currency anymore to repay their debts? Their debts were in euros, and they couldn't print euros themselves. Well, there was a moral hazard problem. The fact that they were in the Eurozone led the buyers of their bonds to think that they were somehow immunized against losses, that nobody would let Greece default on its bonds. And for a while, it looked like they might be right, but of course, Greece did default on its bonds. There wasn't enough willingness on the part of the rest of Europe to subsidize them to the extent that would have been necessary to make all the bondholders whole. But it's a moral hazard problem, whereas under the gold standard, there was no international bailout agency that would rescue a country that over-indebted itself in gold. They were going to have to mend their ways if they wanted to get back into the market. Is it possible to go back to the gold standard? Well, as I said, most central banks have not sold their gold reserves. And the U.S. has plenty of gold to go back on the gold standard at the current price of gold. If you look at $1,400 an ounce, it's a recent level it was at. It might be a little lower today. The gold held by the U.S. government, assuming it has the gold it claims to have, the gold reserves haven't been audited in a while. It's got more than enough to meet required bank reserves. It actually got close to 15% of M1. And by historic standards, that's a large reserve ratio. Banks can operate on a 15% reserve ratio quite easily without ever defaulting on their, well, while rarely defaulting on their obligations. Very low risk of them defaulting on their obligations. In the Eurozone, it's a little harder. I had to do some work here to pile up these numbers. But in the Eurozone, there is enough gold to back Euro M1, 7%, so slightly lower. But compared to current bank reserves, it's also much, much bigger than currently required bank reserves. So we could replace all bank reserves with gold, and then Europe would be on a gold standard. Now, that's a different question from asking whether it's politically feasible. And I don't have any special expertise in judging political feasibility. But we have seen countries adopt something analogous to going on a gold standard, and that is to adopt an external currency standard, which to that country is like being on a gold standard. It's going on a standard that they can't print. Right? And they have to acquire from the rest of the world. So that's dollarization or euroization. So Ecuador did it, of course, in the middle of its hyperinflation. El Salvador is an interesting case. They did it in order to prevent a hyperinflation, in order to solidify. They were already had a fixed exchange rate with the dollar, but it was not a trustworthy exchange rate because they could change it at any time. So they said, let's really credibly tie our own hands, and they dollarized while inflation was actually pretty low. Bulgaria has gone on the euro for the same reason. They had bad experience having their own central bank, but they're not a member of the European Central Bank. They just use the euro unofficially. They have a kind of currency board arrangement locally. So those kind of arrangements are like being willing to go on the gold standard. So, of course, the countries that are going to be most willing to go back on a gold standard or something like it are the ones who've seen most vividly the dangers of having an unanchored currency standard. Well, I think I should wrap it up here, but I've already mentioned some of the common arguments against going back on a gold standard, the resource cost argument, and the purchasing power of gold is too volatile argument. And I guess I've already made the points that we haven't, in fact, saved resource costs. We've increased them by going off the gold standard. And the purchasing power of gold was not volatile under the gold standard. It was only volatile when we demonetized gold. So that's not really relevant to the question of whether we should go back. So I'll stop and take questions. Thank you.